See, you're all familiar that the heart is a electrically active muscle, isn't it? So whenever you want to record the activity of that, you need a few things in hand. So how we can record the ECG? This is ECG, you are familiar with all these things, isn't it? So to record the ECG, you need to place some electrodes on the body surface area so that you can capture those and interpret it in an electronic way. You have three standard leads which are attached to the limbs, right arm and the left arm and the left leg. Then you have augmented voltage leads also, right? Apart from that, you keep the electrodes on the precordial area, which runs from right side of the chest, which captures the right side of the heart to the left, almost up to the anterior axillary line. So this is the recording what you have. If you just blow out a portion of the ECG, this is what you get. Here it is in a grid-like fashion. This is the small square represents 1 square millimeter actually. So the voltage is plotted vertically, then the time is plotted horizontally. So this particular paper runs at a speed of 25 millimeters per second. So considering that, the each small square will represent 0.04 second and the vertical axis will represent 0.1 millivolt in current actually. So the bigger square what you see is the 5 millimeter, because each smaller square is 1 millimeter, so the bigger square will represent around 5 millimeters. The voltage will be around 0.5 millivolt. So for standardization, what they have done, can you see this? This is the standardization what everybody follows actually. So this is a 1 millivolt standardization which represents the voltage. So these are the three things which one has to see. What is the speed of the ECG they have taken? This is one. So that will be written here in the bottom all the time, and the standardization, that's a 1 millivolt. So once you record the ECG, you need to know what are the components of the trace. So there are a few ways which are named alphabetically actually, so P, Q, R, S and T. So the waves which are above the horizontal line are called the positive deflection, below the horizontal line are the negative deflections. So you have P wave, you are familiar, the R wave and the T wave. Q and S are the negative deflection. We have few intervals here, starting of the P wave to the beginning of the Q. This is the PR interval, very popular, isn't it? Apart from that, end of the P wave to the beginning of the Q is the PR segment. This PR segment is also called as an isoelectric line, against which the segment elevation or depression is compared. So this you have to remember, the PR segment is also called as the isoelectric line. So the negative deflection what you see is the Q and S, followed by that is the ST segment, your popular one. So the point where the ST segment start is also called as the J point, against which you will compare whether the ST segment is elevated or it is getting depressed. So following that is the T wave. Apart from that, the one more interval which you have to be familiar with is the QT interval, which starts from the QRS complex to the end of the T wave, right? So all these elements represent some part of the electrical activation of the heart. Few of the one you have to know is the P wave, which represents the atrial depolarization or the atrial contraction, isn't it? QRS represents the ventricular depolarization, the ventricular contraction. T wave represents the repolarization of the ventricles actually. So apart from that, there are a few other you can you'll know in few other waves actually, in coming ways. So whenever you get an ECG, you should know whether the ECG what you got is properly recorded or not, whether the leads are properly placed on the limbs as well as the chest. So for that, you need to remember that the R wave in lead 1 has to be positive all the time, right? So in it should be negative in AVR. So these two things are must. These two findings should are must for a properly taken ECG. So the R wave, since the precordial leads run from V1 to V6, though it should, the ventricular depolarization should increase from V1 to V4. So there is a S wave which should grow from V1 to V3, and by the time it reaches the lateral part of the ventricle, of the left ventricle, it should disappear, right? So these are all minor things, but the main ones you should remember is the R wave should be positive in lead 1 and it should be negative in AVR. So coming to the P wave. So P wave should be positive in 1, 2 and AVR. Right, so the limb leads as well as the AVL, that covers the atrial area. That is the reason the vector travels towards those leads. That is the reason it has to be positive in 1, 2 and AVL. It is negative, always negative in AVR. So if there is any deviation from this finding, you should suspect that the vector is going away or there is some problem with the atrial depolarization. So the normal duration is 0.06 to 0.12 seconds. That's around 1.5 to 2.5 squares actually. The shape is usually smooth. Whenever there is an increase in voltage, it is called P pulmonary, more than 3 small square, that is 0.12 seconds. If it becomes wide, it is called P mitral. So this is in relation to the pressures exerted on the atria, whether it is on the right atria or the left atria, depending on that it is P mitral. So mitral valve is related to the left side. So whenever there is an increased pressure intra-atrially due to any reason, so we will have a P mitral. P pulmonary is a forward pressure basically, so on the right side of the heart. So that whenever there is a issue with the right side of the heart or the pulmonary, you will have P pulmonary. So this P wave is always, majority of the time, it is best seen in lead 2. So if you can just see in this ECG, this is the P wave, it is almost approaching around 5 millimeters. So isn't it? So this is approaching 5 millimeters, that is, it is more than 2.5. This represents the right atrial enlargement. It is also called as P pulmonary. So here, what has happened? This is a bifid or prolonged P wave actually. So this is more than 1.5 to 2 squares. That is the reason we can label it as P mitral, and we should start investigating that patient for the reasons for P mitral. So this is the importance of looking at P waves. So coming to the intervals, we have PR interval. This is from the beginning of the P wave to the beginning of the QRS complex. Normally it is 0.12 to 0.20 seconds, 3 squares to 5 squares maximum, right? So the next is the QRS duration, which starts from the Q wave to the end of the S wave actually. QRS duration, you know that it represents ventricular depolarization. Its maximum squares, what you can get is the 3 squares, 0.12 seconds. Beyond that is called a prolonged QRS duration. So the interval what we talk about is the QT interval, which you have to be familiar with. The first deflection, this is about the Q wave to till the end of the T wave, is the QT interval. So it has to be isoelectric, right? So normally it's around 440 milliseconds. Blowout of the same actually, starting of the QRS complex to the end of the T, QT interval. So it is best measured in the AVL. If you talk about QT interval, definitely it measures ventricular repolarization actually, but it includes ventricular depolarization also. Which wave represents the ventricular depolarization in QT? QRS, isn't it? So QRS, since it includes the ventricular depolarization also, the actual interval, if you talk about ventricular repolarization, is also called as a JT interval actually. So QT interval for clinical purpose you can use it, but if you want to be more accurate, it is the JT interval which you have to be, you have to measure actually. So the popular one, Bezek's formula, since it includes ventricular depolarization, whenever there is a change in heart rate, your QT interval also change. So that is the reason we'll have to correct the QT interval as per the heart rate. So that correction is given by the Bezek's formula, so which is the QT interval divided by square root of the RR interval, right? The normal value in males is around 0.44 seconds and female it is little prolonged, 0.45 to 0.46 seconds. ST segment. So it's ST segment represents the electrical neutrality of the ventricle actually. So J point we have talked about. So this includes the J point. This is the J point actually, which at the end of the S wave to beginning of the T wave. So ST segment is represented by that. Followed by ST segment, you have the T wave. T wave is asymmetrical. If you observe it closely, it is asymmetrical, unlike P wave. P wave is smooth. Most of the times, the T wave, it rapidly climbs up. The amplitude is high. When it starts relaxing, so it is slow. So that is the reason why it is asymmetric actually. So whenever there is a change in amplitude or the size of the T wave, you have to be careful, right? So rarely it exceeds 10 millimeters. It is just to stress the J point actually. We have shown this graph. This is the J point at start of the ST segment, end of the QR. The U waves, once in a while you need to, you will see the Q waves. These are the low voltage waves actually, less than 2 millimeters, best seen in VT2, V4. So it follows the same direction of the T wave. And most commonly you are familiar that it is seen in hypokalemia, once in a while in digoxin toxicity, very rarely in hypercalcemia. So U waves, don't get confused. So all the time it follows after T wave. So how do we estimate? Following knowing the waves actually, we need to know the rate of the particular ECG we are given. We have rule of 300 for that. 300 is the number of squares actually, so which has to be divided by the number of the squares between RR interval, right? We'll go through the example. So if you have 5 large squares, that equals 60 beats per minute. If it is 3, it's around 100. 2 large squares represent 150. So we have a second method also. This method 1, wherein we divide 300 by number of RR interval and 1500 by number of small squares, applies for a rhythm which is regular. So what if you get an irregular rhythm in an ECG? So in that scenario, what you have to do is, you'll have to multiply, you'll have to count the R waves and multiply it by 6, right? So the standard ECG graph, what you get, runs for only 10 seconds. That is the reason. The number of R waves you cover in 10 seconds multiplied by 6 will give you the heart rate in 1 minute. Any volunteer? So what is the heart rate here? So we have 1 square, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 300 divided by 6 will give you 50 beats per minute. So the heart rate of this ECG is 50 beats per minute. Here? So here what you can see, these squares are not very regularly placed. Here you can take help of the smaller square formula, that is 1500. You have around 18 small squares here. 1500 divided by 18 will give you approximately around 78 beats. We are talking about ventricular rate here, not the atrial rate. We'll come to that. What is the heart rate here? So smaller squares again. So it's around 8 small squares. So 1500 divided by 8, it's around 118 beats per minute. Axis determination, it is little tricky if you are not familiar with. So for this, we'll take help of the augmented limb leads and the left arm. This is the augmented left arm limb lead. This is the augmented right arm. Then we have a leg. So AVL, AVR and AVF. So Eindhoven proposed that the left arm and the right arm will be a lead one. The one which measures the potential difference between the right arm and the left leg will be the lead two, and the left between left arm and the left leg is the lead three. So these three leads are in equilateral triangle. So just remember this. So they are at 60 degrees to each other. So if you just place this triangle on the heart, so the lead one represented by the horizontal line, okay, this is 0 to 180 degrees, or you can say 180 degrees. So if you just bring down this lead two to here at exactly 60 degrees, this is at 60 degrees. So lead two is this. Again, the lead three you can bring down to this part. So the long axis of the heart, you have lead two, and the positive deflection is below this. This is the positive deflection. Again, the lead three will be along this 60 degrees. So in lead one, 0 degrees, at 60 you have lead two, and again at 120 you have lead three. These are all positive leads, right? So the vector which travels towards these leads will be give positive deflection in the ECG. So if you talk about other, the augmented limb leads, they are placed at above the horizontal line, that is negative deflection. AVL is at around minus 30 degrees, it is more towards the left. The AVL is extreme left, it is around 150. Then the AVF is at around plus 90, positive deflection. So if you interpose this and this axial reference system, you will have the total axis of any other wave in the ECG, whether it is a QRS or T, you will have the, you can determine the axis of the waves in ECG. So what is the use of that? This is how you determine the axis. So just concentrate on this yellow area. This is the normal axis of the heart. So that is why if you have a QRS complex which is in leads 1 and 2 is positive, upright, so that axis, QRS axis, is a normal axis. If you get a QRS axis which is positive in lead 1 positive, okay, but it is negative in lead 2, the axis will be leftwards. Lead 2 is always, like, if it is negative, it goes up, isn't it? So the axis is leftward. So if you find the QRS complex negative both lead 1 and AVF, now you are coming towards the positive side, AVF. So the lead 1 is negative in the QRS is negative in lead 1, but it is in positive in AVF. The axis is rightwards. This is the rightward axis of the heart, actually. So this is right axis deviation. Suppose if you get negative QRS in lead 1 and AVF, so that means lead 1 and AVF, if you can remember the previous one, so that axis falls somewhere here. So this is a extreme axis deviation, actually, which is very rare, actually. Then it is also called as a northwest axis, as in relation to the different direction we have, right? So that is also called as northwest axis. This is how we can determine the axis of any other waves we get. So there is also a simpler method wherein you just see which of the wave is in isoelectric. Isoelectric means this is the isoelectric line, the PR segment. So the complex has to be equal in one of the lead. So just see that and see. So here, for example, if the QRS is isoelectric in lead 3, this is the isoelectric line, actually. So what you have to do, you have to take a lead which is exactly 90 degrees or perpendicular. The lead or the axis which is perpendicular to 120 is the 30 to 150, isn't it? So this is the 90 degrees, here is also the 90 degrees. So your QRS axis might lie between either plus 30 or minus 150. This is a simpler one, but the most accurate is the earlier one which we went through. So you'll have to memorize that, and it is easy. Otherwise you have a thumb method also, which you are familiar with the older students, actually. So here the left axis, if you talk about left axis, your QRS will fall between minus 30 to minus 20, sorry 90, minus 30 to minus 90. So you can have left axis deviation normally also, and whenever there is a pushing of the apex towards the left, by either because of the ascites or pregnancy or even the abdominal tumor, you can have left axis deviation. So if you have a conduction issues, so if the bundle branch block is there, especially the left bundle branch block or the left ventricular hypertrophy, muscle hypertrophy, so we'll have a vector which is more placed towards the left axis. So if you consider myocardial infarction, inferior MI can give you LVVV pattern actually, left axis deviation as well as hyperkalemia. If you consider right axis deviation is plus 90 to 180 actually. So you can have it in tall subjects wherein the heart is little vertical. So you can have right axis deviation, again the RVH, RVBE, left posterior hemi block, dextrocardia and lateral wall MI. Lateral wall MI you'll have to remember for RVBB, inferior for LV, left axis deviation actually. Come to the bradyarrhythmias. So sinus node dysfunction, definitely there is some problem with the SA node. Either it is sluggish or there is no activity at all, or it is not performing as a normal pacemaker. So then you will have sinus node dysfunction. Popularly it is known as the sick sinus syndrome also. So the commonly the patients will have some amount of dizziness or some lightheadedness, or they can have presyncopal or syncope also if they have bradycardia or sinus pass. So it is always diagnosed with ECG, not clinically. You will suspect clinically. When you take a ECG, you will have this sinus pauses and the bradycardia. So you can diagnose it with sometimes 1 to 14 days holter also. In ECG, you will have brady, sinus arrest or sinus pause. If is an incidental finding, just observe the patient. Nothing to be done for that. If they are symptomatic, they need a permanent pacemaker. Pre-lunch. Okay, right. So bradycardia, right? Sinus bradycardia. Why we had to say it is sinus bradycardia? So we see P wave, okay, before each QRS. This is a P wave, P wave, P wave, P wave, right? So the PR interval is 0.12 to 0.20. QRS is narrow, okay? So all intervals are normal. The heart rate is less than 60. So brady is less than 60 beats per minute, isn't it? So it can be a physiological, or it can be induced by drugs also. So this is just as a prelude to the blocks actually. You will have to go through this conduction system so that you will understand or recapitulate things well. So SA nodes will be somewhere here, AV node into bundle office, divides into left bundle branch and the right bundle branch. In the left bundle branch, you have left posterior and the left anterior fascicle. So just remember these four things. So things will be easy in a conduction blocks. So junctional rhythm. What do you mean by junctional rhythm? So the pacemaker or the stimulus for the heart is not coming from the SA node, it is at the junction of the atria and the ventricle. So you will have a junctional rhythm. Why? Since the SA node is not the normal pacemaker, so you will not have any P wave, isn't it? So no P wave before QRS. It can, if the refractory period of the AV node is different or is not able to conduct, you can get the P wave either with the QRS or after the QRS. So there is a total disconnection between the atria and ventricle. That is why we call it as AV dissociation. You can have junctional tachycardia. The pacemaker might be producing the heart rate more than 100 actually. So altogether, your junctional tissue which is pacing the heart might take total control of the heart, wherein we call it as junctional escape rhythm. Right? What happens here? As we are know, it is not a SA node, so the heart rate will be less than 60. You will have a heart rate of 40 to 60 actually. The rhythm is regular. Okay? The P wave, since it is not from the SA node, P wave is not upright, you will get inverted P wave. It can be absent, and you can get the P wave after QRS also. Only thing is, you should be careful enough to identify which is P, right? So the PR interval is less than 0.12 because there is no problem with the conduction to the ventricles. The QRS is less than 0.12. Junction rhythm. Come to the blocks actually. So the blocks here, what is the first degree? There is some problem with the AV node actually. There is a delay in the AV node. So because of that, the PR interval gets prolonged. It is more than 0.20 seconds, right? So if the patient is asymptomatic, there is no, even if the symptoms are there, then you'll have to try to find out why the PR interval is getting prolonged. So normally there is no treatment required. Come to second degree AV block. Here you have Mobitz type 1 and type 2. Mobitz type 1, what happens in type 1? There is a increasing delay at the AV node. So the PR interval is not conducted, and there is gradual prolongation of the PR interval. This is what you see here. This is the PR here. This is the PR. It is the length of the PR interval getting prolonged, right? So since the ventricles are getting the impulses, but they're getting in a different fashion, the QRS is narrow. Okay, so this is of normal. This most of the times happens with the inferior wall MI, one as the AV node is involved. So if there is no bradycardia, there is no need to pace. If the patient is asymptomatic, don't do. If the patient is symptomatic, then you'll have to intervene. Coming to Mobitz type 2, here what is happening? Your P wave are getting dropped. The PR interval is prolonging, but at the same time, some of the P waves are not transmitted to the ventricle. So the excitation doesn't take place. That is why you will lose a QRS here. So you can see the next QRS is supposed to be here, somewhere here, right? It's approximately three squares. So you don't get a QRS here. So that ventricular depolarization is missing here. So that is the type 2. So since the ventricular depolarization is happening by itself, you will have a prolonged QRS. QRS around, not narrow, it is little prolonged. So most of the time it is a precursor to the complete heart blocks. Definitely you need a it needs to be paced as soon as possible. Complete heart block. So here ventricles are not at all receiving the P waves actually, P wave excitation. That is the reason the atria is contracting on its own, and the ventricle is contracting on its own. So there is a atrioventricular dissociation. Can you see this? This is the P wave, this is the P wave, P wave. We can have a regular, the interval between the two P waves and this P wave is almost the same. There is some variation here. Apart from that, you can see the ventricular rate is different. Here the P wave rate is different. So the atria is contracting in a different rate and the ventricle is contracting in a different rate. So that's the complete heart block. It is a emergency. Need to pace the patient. Coming to LBBB, left bundle branch block, you have gone through the conduction system. So left ventricle gets the delayed impulse. That is why the QRS is widened at least more than 3 squares, that is more than 0.12 seconds. Monophasic in lead 1, remember this, monophasic in lead 1 and V6, and there is no Q wave. You should not see any Q wave. Predominantly it is negative in V1, and even you will have a small R, it might be present or absent. See, always the small R is represented by the low voltage waves actually. So whenever you see a capital in ECG, it is a high voltage or a normal voltage wave. Small voltages less than 0.5 millivolt are represented with the smaller, it's in the V wave. So the upright QRS in lead 1 and V6 here, the negative deflection in V1 represents the left bundle branch block. So if the patient is symptomatic, needs a pacemaker. Coming to the RBBB, So QRS is definitely, it is widened, but you will have RSR pattern in V1 and V2. This is the V1 and V2. So typical RSR, small r, the normal S and R waves are represented like this. This is the R wave, then the negative deflection is the S wave, this is the R wave again. So this is the RSR pattern you should look in V1. You will have a wide slurred S wave in lead one also. This also you should be able to appreciate. If you see these findings, that is a right bundle branch block. So right bundle branch block doesn't bother you much, like doesn't trouble the patient much. LBB is more important. Coming to tachyadmias, you can have supraventricular and the ventricular tachyadmia. Supraventricular will have atrial fibrillation, flutter. Ventricular tachycardia, you can have monomorphic ventricular, polymorphic. In polymorphic, you can have torsade ponte, right? Then the fibrillation. Narrow complex, agree, right? Narrow complex, apart from that, regular, irregular?
Regular.
Regular, okay. What is that? So, supraventricular tachycardia, it starts from above the AV node, within the atria actually. So, that's a re-entrant arrhythmia in the AV node. So, because of that, the atrial depolarization happens because of the re-entrant pathway actually. So you will have a narrow QRS complex with tachycardia more than 100. So the ideally you can terminate most of the time by the Valsalva manual or the carotid sinus massage. What you are trying to do is trying to increase the vagal output actually. If there is no response to your vagal manoeuvres, what you have to do? Learn to use drugs. Adenosine and verapamil are the one. So adenosine is the most popular one. You'll have to give 6, 12 and 18. So if it doesn't respond to the drugs, you can go for RFA. Right? This is what the algorithm says actually. So just assess for the appropriateness of the rhythm actually. So if the patient is symptomatic in the sense basically they can have perfusion abnormalities or hypotension. So once I'm see is there any QRS complex is narrow or wide, once you know that it is a narrow complex, if they have not responded to the drugs, you can go for DC shock, low voltage, 50 to 100 joules biphasic, right? That's for SVT. This one, I'll give you a clue. Narrow complex, agree, right? So the P-wave morphology is changing. Tachycardia, more than 100, P-wave morphology is changing, right? So MAT, automatic atrial rhythm, you have different foci in atria. That is the reason you'll have different morphology of the P waves. More than 3 types of P waves in any other ECG, more than 100 beats per minute, you should suspect that this ECG belongs to a patient who is having multifocal atrial tachycardia. Commonly it is seen in COPD patients, isn't it? So any clinical situation where you suspect that hypoxia is there, then you can have MAT also. Along with that, a left atrial or right atrial enlargement can also induce MAT. Elderly, it is very common. Electrolyte disturbance, hypokalemia, you can see this commonly. Drug-induced isoproterenol, aminophilins, theophilins can induce that. So since you should not prolong the conduction, so digoxin, you should not use digoxin. What you can use is the verapamil or diltiazem. There is one more entity without tachycardia actually, so that is also called as a wandering atrial pacemaker. So tachycardia is there, it is MAT. If there is no tachycardia but you are able to see more than 3 types of different P wave morphology, it is wandering atrial pacemaker. That is to earn some brownie points, right? So here, so P waves are present, yes, ATL rate is around 150. I worked it for you. It is regular. QRS interval is 0.12, but ventricular rate is 132. ATL rate is 250, ventricular rate is 132. It is regular. You want to go for lunch, you have to answer fast. So flutter. So flutter is always, if you see sawtooth appearance, that's a spot diagnosis. You should not hesitate to say that it is something else. So atrial flutter was that ECG. All the time you'll have to see what is the conduction which is happening, whether it is 2:1 or 3:1. Always there will be a conduction block, because ventricle AV node is not made to receive the signal so fast. That is why you will have conduction block. So RR interval is always in multiple of 300. What you have to do, you will have to slow the conduction either with amiodarone, propofol or sotalol. So if the patient is unstable for any arrhythmia for that matter, so you will have to de-seek cardio work. Long term basis, if it is recurrent, then you will have to go for radio frequency ablation. Popular. Narrow complex, right? Tachycardia, agree? Irregular. So commonest arrhythmia, definitely everyone agrees for that. So commonly seen in hypertensive heart disease, coronary artery disease, rheumatic heart disease, nowadays rarely seen, sick sinus, WW, and thyrotoxicosis. Paroxysmal is less than 7 days. If it is persistent, it is more than 7 days. You have many other types of atrial fibrillation in persistent. You will have to go through that. Therapy is the rate control all the time, not the rhythm control. So don't concentrate on rhythm control. Rate control with the stroke prophylaxis, then followed by rhythm control. So what are the drugs you use? This is the same flowchart as in ACLS actually. Right. So if you had to cardiovert, you had to use 100 to 120 to 200 joules biphasic. When do you cardiovert? Unstable, clinically significant atrial fibrillation, unstable, your patient is collapsing in front of you, so you'll have to defibrillate. WPW. So this happens because of the accessory pathway. If you can have a local reentry mechanism here within the atria actually. So the global reentry is happens whenever there is a reentry mechanism between the atria and ventricle. So the local reentry is within the single chamber. This is the two chambers actually. So the common one is the bundle of Kent what you have. So what you see here is the QRS, narrow QRS, normal QRS actually. So we'll have a shorter PR because you have an accessory pathway through which the conduction takes place. That is the reason you'll have a short PR and a prolonged QRS. So all the time you'll have to go for the EPS studies, electrophysiological studies, to know the accessory pathway. If required, all the time you'll have to ablate that pathway so that you can have a normal rhythm. So the other thing what you have to observe is the slurred QRS. Okay, so this is the normal path. Once you have a normal pathway, once you have an accessory pathway, that conducts the electrical signal fast. That is the reason you will have a slur wave, which is also called as the delta wave. So you'll have to look for this delta wave all the time. Once you see that, you know that that's a WPW. So should not use medications that slow the AV node. So don't use digoxin beta blockers or adenosine or calcium channel. Procainamide is the one which slows down the accessory pathway. So drug of choice is procainamide if you had to use the drug. Chest pain, palpitation. What is happening here? QRS, something is wrong with the QRS, right? Again, wide QRS complexes, regular, no change in shape. Good. So that's the ventricular tachycardia. So what is happening here? The ventricle is getting the electrical impulses by itself. That's the reason. You'll have a rate of around 140 to 250, unstable, under stable. Okay. So we'll have to cardiovert the unstable patient. Sometimes resistant cases can be dealt with pre-shock amiodarone. So on long-term basis, you'll have to consider procainamide. What is sustained and non-sustained? How many? 45 seconds? 30 seconds. Okay. So sustained is more than 30 seconds. Non-sustained is less than 30. So that's the algorithm. Shockable, since it is a shockable rhythm. So we'll have to go for a DC shock, then at the same time go for intravenous access. If still you're not able to, with the shock you're not able to convert it, go for two shocks. Following that, you'll have to start using the adenalin, right? And at the simultaneously, you'll have to protect the airway also. Then after two shocks, use three shocks, use amiodarone. Following that, you can go for that. What is happening here? PQRS, okay, so QRS is there, QRS complex is there, this is QRS again, QRS, so changing QRS, polymorphic, then what it is? Torsade, Ponte. So you have twisting points around the QRS. The first distinguishing feature, what you have to see is the QT interval. So if you have a prolonged QT with the polymorphic VT, which is called a torsade. Otherwise, you have a polymorphic VT without prolonged QT interval. What it is called? What is this? Polymorphic, we don't have QT, so it is ventricular fibrillation. So ventricular fibrillation with a normal QT interval is okay. So this is most common in MI, also in drug overdose, anesthesia, hypothermia, electric shock can also precipitate accidental electric shock, right, at home or somewhere else. So there is no discernible ventricular complexes. It is usually a terminal event, as you have seen in the resuscitation protocol. So if it is refractory to defibrillation, use amiodarone. This is what the shockable rhythm protocol. So this is about elderly gentleman who comes in unconscious state with no pulse, but he has got electrical activity at the heart. Right. So it is come to this portion, think of causes of PEA, Hs and Ts here. You can see some pacing things. So only ventricle is pacing, that is the ventricular pacing. Here it is the atria and ventricles both are paced. Few slides about MI. This is the evolution of the ST segment, what you can see in the earlier than the later, you will have the inverted T waves. So persistence of ST segment elevation even beyond 2-3 days, what it indicates? Ventricular aneurysm, right. So ECG localization of infarct is also important. If you have ST segment changes in 2-3 AVF, which represents the inferior wall, that's the inferior wall MI. Lateral wall is represented by 1 AVL V5 V6. So ST segment changes, elevations in these leads represent the lateral wall. The anterior is represented by the V2-3-4. Then the septal is by V12 to V3. So just we'll try to identify. So V1 and V4, that's the anterior wall, right? Which am I? 2-3 AVF with reciprocal changes here. So that's the inferior wall MI. Right here, 1 AVL, then here. So that's the anterolateral. So this gentleman has missed dialysis sessions. You have tall peaked T waves, that represents the hyperkalemia, right? This one, Chaucer's. Okay. QRS, you can see any prolongation of the QT here. So that is the reason we have put it here. So all the time look for QT interval. QT interval is there, then you can say it is Chaucer's point. If no QT interval, you cannot say it is a Chaucer's, whether it is a VF or QT. So you are on popular demand. Right? So today is International Women's Day. These are four of our team members. Dr. Kirti is missing here. So the slogan is for Think Equal, Build Smart, Innovate for Change. That's for you.
Thank you, sir. We have one more talk before lunch.